I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. In our song today, we hear about the righteous being seen as the tree that's planted by a stream of water, with its roots going way down deep. And as I thought about that, it reminded me of when Renata had gone to France. And we were there partly to find out about Renée's history as a Borsée in France and all this good stuff. And so we went to visit this 92-year-old grandma-type relative. And as we got to her house, we're trying to find everybody. And there's, we hear voices out in the yard, and we go around the corner, and there is this humongous chestnut tree. It's huge. It's been there forever. And all folks were whacking at it to get the chestnuts down. You've got to be careful when people are whacking chestnuts down, and you'll get one in your head. Anyway, as we were leaving the chestnut tree, the 92-year-old grandma says, Racine, Racine. And I'm going, what is this? And the only place I'd seen Racine was on a pop can that was for root beer. And I'm going, And then it came to me, roots. Where are your roots? Who do you belong to? And she wasn't going to take Canadian for an answer, folks. I've got to tell you this. As far as she was concerned, Canadian did not cut it. You had to go further back than that. And, you know, because to her, like 500 years was yesterday. So it was just amazing. So I'm going, I'm living on. But the question we've got here today, as we look at our Gospels from last week and today, is who do we belong to? In a world that is very rootless. Hey, Canadians come from all over. I was sitting at a meeting yesterday and nobody had come from the Okanagan even. It was everybody had come from somewhere else. So who do we belong to? And that's a deep and abiding question for anyone. Who do we belong to? And so last week, we heard Jesus asking the disciples, well, who do people say that I am? And Peter, smart guy on the block, says, you're the Messiah. Now, of course, we realize as we go along that Peter's vision of the Messiah is this incredible military king that's going to come in and he's going to get rid of those Romans and they're going to get out and we're going to be in the promised land and it's all going to be wonderful for us. And Jesus goes on to say, well, you know what? Sorry about that, but that vision of the Messiah really isn't the one. In fact, I'm going to be betrayed, and then I'm going to be killed, and then I'm going to rise again in 3 days. Got it? No, they didn't get it. So, but they had, as disciples, understood that they were following the Messiah. And they didn't get it, but they kind of got it. That they were following this guy who had shown them a world that they hadn't seen before. So today, we get another kick at Jesus trying to tell the disciples what's coming up. And hey guys, I just want to just give you a flag, FYI, I'm going to be betrayed, I'm going to be killed, and then I'm going to rise again in 3 days. And they still don't get it. In fact, they don't have a clue. And so if they kind of wander along the road, kind of saying, hey, I'm the best disciple, you got, I'm the best one. No, you're not. No, you're not. I'm the best one, you know, because I'm the good guy here. And Jesus doesn't exactly hear them, but he knows something's going on. And so he gets out of them that they are asking, who is the greatest of them all, meaning the disciples. And the question that's behind that really is, how do you know, how do you show that you're a follower of the Messiah? How do you show that you're a Christian? How do you show that you're a disciple? And I have to share with you, Chris and Gary will appreciate this. The North Okanagan clerics get together in the brew pub in Salmon. So, there they are, the two guys all dressed in their clericals. I, on the other hand, would prefer to be more stylish. Do not. However, hey. So, we're heading out the door, and Chris has to go to the washroom, and Gary's standing there in his pristine new clericals, because he's our new deacon now. And it's all great, and these two 20-something gals at the bar who are having their noontime beer say, hey, what are a bunch of clergy guys doing at the brew pub? And we said, oh, we're just having a meeting, you know, just getting together. Oh, wow, that's really cool. And so then they say, so where's the church? And we say, sort of down the road. And what time's the service? Well, really, we don't know, because actually we're from another church. But the guy outside, he knows. And then Chris comes along in his clergy shirt. And by this point, I'm kind of going, hey, gee, I wish I wore my clergy shirt. because it was so easy. It was so easy. These guys have Christian written all over their foreheads. I mean, it was so simple. Just wear the clergy shirt. They'll know who you are. And so I'm going, oh, well. But how do the rest of us who don't wear clergy shirts let the world know who we are? And the answer comes with Jesus sitting down in the midst of his disciples and bringing a little child to the center and saying, you welcome the child. You are serving to all. Now, we all see that little vignette about Jesus and the child. And we go, isn't that just so sweet? And isn't Jesus such a great guy? He just loves those children. Except in his day, to even see a child being present was to acknowledge somebody who was a nobody. Because children in first century Rome were simply a mouth to be fed, somebody to be clothed. They weren't paying their own way yet. I tell you, this kid's gonna kill me. I don't know how I can afford him. Are you kidding me? Get the heck out of here. Silence is golden. I don't really want to know you're here. That's who children were in Jesus' day. For Jesus to bring that child forward and place him or her in the midst was to say, we are welcoming the outsider. We are welcoming the stranger. We are welcoming the nobody, the person you don't even hardly see. We're welcoming the one who can give us nothing. Can give us nothing. That's who we are called to welcome. And that's who, as a community, we will be known as. What we will be known as, the community of welcome. Now, I don't know about you, but it's not the easiest thing to go up to somebody I don't know and say, hi, I'm Jane, and I'm so glad you're here. I would think that was easy, but it's not. How do we do that? How do we blast through our fear, our anxiety, our sense of hesitation, our sense of being sort of British-y reserved types? How do we do that? It's because we are rooted, raceted in the love of God. We are deeply, the Christ's community. We are deeply rooted in that, and in that rootedness, we find the strength to just plow through. So, folks, the challenge is on. We have to become a welcoming community. I would love it that anybody who